some investigation, and you'll find that these things are done because they want to do the same thing they have been doing over the, through the years, and that is dividing and conquering. Why do you think Kennedy was killed? Because he was not a racist. Why do you think Dr. King was killed? Malcolm X, and many others who have tried to work to lift up the fall, whether he's white or black, because hate is like a cancer. It starts with just a little pimple, and then we think sometimes mentally, well, that's not gonna hurt, that'll soon get well. And soon it envelops the entire body, and there is no hope. This is what the system is trying to do to you and to me. But thanks be to God, he gave us a mind to use and a mind to know what is right and what is wrong. So I'm saying to you, if you want to grow, whether a person is a Jew or a Gentile, whether he's white or he's black, if he has what it takes to improve our minds and to give us the opportunity to improve this in ourselves and our surroundings, then I say you need to accept it. And I'm very proud that I'm a member of this organization. I have to say that because I am disappointed because of the crowd. These young people have worked so hard, and the adults have come from a number of places just in order to entertain this community and this district. And if we think anything, if we don't think anything about ourselves, let us think about the young people. Let us think of what they are doing to bring to us some of the things maybe that we have forgotten. Now, we speak very often of slavery. Yes, every nation, every country, or every race in the world has been enslaved sometime. But the slaves were slaves physically. Yes, some of them were in chains. Some of them could not go any specific place. But freedom mentally is what they were. And that's why the back of slavery was broken. Because they were free mentally. You listen to these songs that these young people are going to sing and the chorus will sing. It will show you that though they were in chains, they knew being a child of God and having a determination not to let the master tell them what to do mentally, and they became free. The reason I wrote this play through the years, and I want you to know that this is history. Everything in it is true. Most of it is where I contacted personally people whom these young people are going to represent. Other, I got out of history. So you will see, if a person who is enslaved mentally does not have to be, it can't get anywhere. Physically, you can take those chains off of you. Mentally, you are almost like a dead person, and that's what the federal government is doing now. That's what Gingrich is doing. That's the plan, that they will divide us and conquer us. So this play was written because that's what was happening in Selma and Dallas County. And when I saw that these people would come from the country, now some of the older ones might have known about it and some of the younger ones might have heard, but all over the South, they had Saturday off. And on Saturday, they would come to the town, and there they would meet their friends. It was just like a picnic. And what happened in Selma happened to other places too. They would bring their entire family. The stores were around because there the whites were for the purpose of trying to get every dollar they had. But when they would go into the stores, they would buy if they had money. If it were raining, the sun was shining too hot, or if it were freezing, and they went into these stores, the storekeeper will say, what do you want? And they would say, well, some of them, I don't have any money, but I'm out of the rain. Get out, just get out, and let somebody who's got some money come in. And they would mill around downtown. They would nurse, just get on the side, the curb, sit down and eat whatever they had to eat. They had no toilets. They had nothing at all, no building except our office. And they would nurse their babies sitting on the curb. My husband and I said, let us try to get a community center, someplace they can come in out of the cold, that they will have toilets and whatnot. He went to Washington 3 times, and this is back there in the 30s. 3 times he was rejected by the federal government, would not listen. Then he came up upon an idea. He said, and I'm saying this because I want you to know that people are the same regardless of color. You've got people who love us and who want to do everything that they can to help us if we help ourselves. This white man was a minister, and my husband said, suppose we raise money and send Reverend Gamble to Washington. How are you going to raise money? The people in the rural had no money. People had no money. This is during the Depression. So I said, well, let me write a play. And I thought about what my people have come through. And I wrote this play through the years. It is a play that shows, regardless of physically how you are, mentally, you can rise to the top. These young people who are in these plays, it makes no difference where they came from, what the situation is, all of them can rise to the top and be a Joshua. And if you know the Bible, you know what Joshua did. So I say, this play is for you. I want you to be comfortable, to sit, and in your mind, realize how you can rise or how you can help others rise. Because I feel about the African Americans, like my mother told a little girl on the street. This little girl was tall, but she didn't want to be tall. She was humped over, just trying to be short like the rest of them. And my mother walked up to her and she said, before she knew it, she smacked the little girl in the back. She said, hold up your shoulders. Remember, you are descendants of kings and queens, and all you've got to do is to act like it. And I say that to each and every one of you. We are descendants of kings and queens, and now is the time for us to act like it and get these young people to know that you are the greatest that God ever put on the face of the earth.
The same foreground that I dedicated to God would then be ready to die.
Oh, Granddad Joshua, don't talk like that. Why, we would never be able to get along without you. You meant everything to us. I feel sorry for the person who was in no way connected with this family. You know something? The reason I made all those letters in history is because I have a human history who knows the answers to all questions. You are truly a great man, and you're all. A slave, a congressman, a statesman, a school teacher, a farmer, the Maine Underground Railroad conductor, and most of all, you are the father, grandfather, and great-grandfather of some of the greatest leaders of the nation. I wish I had a telescope to look back through the years. Surely the words, stony the roads we trod, bitter the chastening rods, felt in the days when hopes unborn had died, would make me realize that no obstacle is too great to conquer after what you've been through, but I'm meditating unnecessarily. Tell me all about it, Granddad. Someday, I will write a book this thick, and I will call it Joshua's Plan.
I can remember ever so far back, perhaps farther back than most people. I was born in a log cabin right here on the same spot of ground that this house now covers. There were nine of us living, eating, and sleeping in one room. And when the weather was hot, Ma had to move outside to do her cooking. Yeah. My parents loved each other, and they adored their children. Mom never forgot us and the best of the children. And the rest of the children, they were sold down in Mississippi. And our alone were left with mother. I used to love to hear Ma talk about Tom, how he used to try and please her, and how he would kiss every one of us every night, and how he would pray to God to always watch over us and to protect us from danger, although he never seemed to worry about protecting himself from danger. There were many a whip on his back when he was whipped for trying to protect his family. Ma never forgot over her loneliness for Paul. Why, she would sit sometimes and cry for hours. And when I approached her and tried to wipe away her tears with my dirty little hand, she would cry that much more. She would put me on her lap and said, "Son, you can never understand. You are too young to know what it's all about. But you promised me one thing, that you'll always be a good little boy. And if you can get away from here, you get away from here as fast as your little feet can carry you. You ain't going to go through what I was going through. The rivers are wide and the rivers are deep, but you cross them even if you have to swim them." Yeah, she knew what she was talking about, all right. And after such lectures, it seemed as though she was relieved. Then she began to sing. It seemed as though I can hear her singing now.
Oh. My seventh child, he's born for good luck. Look at his ear and tiny fingers. Why, he's got 6 fingers on each hand. I know he's born for good luck. He's been born to lead our people. Daddy sure is. Him bigger than most babies. Daddy sure is. Good luck bound for him. We'll call him Joshua. That's a big name.
Sure, that's a big name. He the seventh child and the seventh son. I'm the seventh child and don't you think I'm lucky? Ain't I lucky to have you as my wife? I sure love you, Mama. And look at these fine children. I'd do anything for my family.
Oh, Rastus, you kissed the nicest thing I ever heard. I pray God we can be together always. Julia, you know I've done told you you ate to eat with both hands. How is you ever gonna be trained to work in the big house? I ain't training you, nor none of my children folks to be no field hands. You got to do things right, my child. You got your sisters and brothers to lead. Now put that hand in your lap and eat your bread with that hand. Sophia, fan them flies and don't let them light on the table. I haven't heard a sign of a blessing from none of you. Fold your hands. Heed after me, children. Thank God for our daily bread. Amen.
Thank God for our daily bread. Amen.
Mother and father were the greatest people in the world to me. And being with them so snugly in their own little cabin, I supposed it to be their own, knowing no higher authority over me, the other children. So I supposed it to be their own, knowing no higher authority over me or the other children than the authority of Mama. For a time there was nothing to disturb me. But as I grew larger and older, I learned by degrees the sad fact that the little hut and the lot on which it stood belonged not to my dear old parents, but to some person who lived a great distance off, and it was called by mother, Old Master. I further learned the sadder fact that not only the house and the lot, but that mother herself and all the little children around her belonged to this mysterious personage, called by mother, with every mark of reverence, Old Master. I was not long in finding out another fact, still more grievous to my childish heart. I was told that this old master, whose name seemed ever to be mentioned with fear and shuddering, only allowed the children to live with mother for a limited time, and in fact, that as soon as they were big enough, they were promptly taken away to live with the said old master. These were distressing revelations indeed. The absolute power of this distant old master had touched my young spirit and left me something to brood over after in play and in moments of repose. But in all my sports and plays, and in spite of them, there would occasionally come the painful foreboding that I must soon be called away to the home of old master. I was a slave, born a slave. And though the fact was incomprehensible to me, it conveyed to my mind a sense of entire independence, dependence on the will of somebody I had never seen. And from some cause or other, I had been made to fear this somebody above all else on earth.
I'm going to lay down this heavy load.
Stop, horse, and don't move there.
I'm going to lay down this heavy load. Oh,
get you ready, there's a
bin here tonight.
There's a bin in the world tonight.
Get you ready, there's a
bin here tonight.
Come along, there's a
bin here tonight. I know you by a daily walk. There's a bin here tonight.
Get you ready, there's a
bin here tonight.
Come along, there's a
bin here tonight. I know you by your daily walk. There's a bin here tonight.
Camp meeting out in the wilderness.
There's a bin here tonight.
I know it's among the Methodists.
There's a bin here tonight.
Get you ready, there's a
bin here tonight. I know you by your daily walk. There's a bin here tonight.
Trumpet sounds within my soul.
I got home to stay.
Yes. Please gather here together. and one covenant.
Amen.
That is to stick together and believe in God.
Amen.
With God above us and off our head and hills.
Amen.
Children?
Yes.
Do you remember Moses?
Yes.
And oh yes, he prayed to God.
Yes,
and he took them by his hand.
Yes. Amen. Amen.
And he led them out of a cursed land.
So, amen.
Now, I want all of y'all to listen while I read this from the Holy Bible. Say, yes, King Jesus. Say, yes, King Jesus.
Read.
Say, pray, children, pray.
Amen.
Remember, children, pray, children, pray.
Yes, indeed, amen.
Now, hear what God says. Now, I want you to listen while I read it to you. And the Lord spoke unto Moses, and go unto Pharaoh, and say unto him, thus saith the Lord, let my people go. So right here, dear, you see that God freed all the children of Israel. I said, God freed all.
Hallelujah.
And he will free us. Now, I want to read you another scripture here.
All right, man, all right.
And to pray, children, pray. The Lord, we just want to praise your holy name.
Yes,
thank you. Thank you. We just want to say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your many blessings.
Amen.
I'm going to read from Exodus, the 12th chapter.
All right.
I will start at the 29th verse. And it came to pass that at midnight the Lord spoke all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sat on his throne, unto the firstborn of the captive that was in the dungeon.
All right.
Also, all the firstborn of cattle. And Pharaoh rose up in the night. He and all of his servants and all the Egyptians. And there was a great cry. For there was not one house where there was not one day. And he called for Moses and Aaron by night.
Yeah.
And he said,
rise up
and get your oath from among my people and go serve the Lord as you have seen.
Yeah.
I said, glory!
It was good for my old mother. It's good enough for me.
Oh,
was good for Paul and Silas.
It was good for Paul and Silas.
It was good for Paul and Silas.
It's good enough for me.
Give me that old-time religion.
Give me that old-time religion.
Oh, give me that old-time religion.
It's good enough for me.
I can't tell for the love of man where them slaves done gone to. I was sure I could hear right here.
I thought so too. You reckon they done went through the ground?
Yeah.
I don't see how nor how. I know what I can do. I'll shoot this direction. Maybe I'll scare them up some a while.
Shoot them up. Shoot them up.
Give me that old-time religion.
It's good enough for me.
It was good for Paul and Silas.
It was good for Paul and Silas.
It was good for Paul and Silas.
It's good enough for me.
Give me that old-time religion.
Give me that old-time religion.
Oh, give me that old-time religion.
It's good enough for me.
It was good when I'm in trouble.
It was good when I'm in trouble.
It was good when I'm in trouble.
It's good enough for me.
Oh, give me that old-time religion.
Give me that old-time religion.
Give me that old-time religion.
It's good enough for me.
I did not, when a slave, understand the deep meanings of those rude and apparently incoherent songs called spirituals. I was myself within the circle, so that I neither saw nor heard as those without might see and hear. They told a tale which was then altogether beyond my feeble comprehension. They were tones, loud, long, and deep, breathing the prayer and complaint of souls boiling over with the bitterest anguish. Every tone was a testimony against slavery and a prayer to God for deliverance from chains. To those songs I traced my first glimmering conceptions of the dehumanizing character of slavery. I can never get rid of that conception. Those songs will follow me to deepen my hatred of slavery and quicken my sympathies for my brethren in bonds. The remark is not unfrequently made that slaves are the most contented and happy laborers in the world. They dance and sing and make all manner of joyful noises. So they do. But it is a great mistake to suppose them happy because they sing. The songs of the slave represent the sorrows rather than the joys of his heart. And he is relieved by them, only as an aching heart is relieved by its tears. Such is the constitution of the human mind that when pressed to extremes, it often avails itself of the most opposite methods. When slaves were overtaken, arrested, and carried to prison, their hopes of freedom blasted as they marched in chains. They sang and found relief in singing. Sorrow and desolation have their songs, as well as joy and peace. Slaves sing more to make themselves happy than to express their happiness.
picking so bad. Cotton he's picking so bad, Lord, I'll pick all over this field. Cotton he's picking so bad. Cotton he's picking so bad. Cotton he's picking so bad, Lord, I'll pick all over this field. Cotton he's picking so bad. Cotton he's picking so bad. Cotton he's picking so bad, Lord, I'll pick all over this field. We sow the seeds in April and chop it out so soon. You'll let the sun, the moon come down, what help it is the moon. Cotton he's picking so bad. Cotton he's picking so bad. Cotton he's picking so bad, Lord, all over this field. Cotton he's picking so bad. Cotton he's picking so bad. Cotton he's picking so bad, Lord, I'll pick all over this field.
What do you think this is? A farm man? Get that sack on your back and get the pick and cut.
I'm sick. I just can't.
The heck you can? And I'll tell you by being the blood around you. Makes no difference if you're sick. I ain't gonna let it rain on this here cotton. Get yourself up!
If you hit her again, white folks, I swear I'll kill you. I don't mind dying. You see, I'll get even with you. I tell you, I'll get even with you.
I'll beat you black as the coal tomorrow. Just in your way.
Oh, my, speak to me. Please don't leave me. I'll take you away from this place and you only live.
Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Master Hugh unfolded to his wife the true philosophy of the slave system. Of course, he forbade her to give me further instruction in reading, telling her in the first place that to do so was unlawful, as it was also unsafe. For, said he, if you give a nigger an inch, he will take a mile. Learning will spoil the best nigger in the world. If he learns to read the Bible, it will forever unfit him to be a slave. He should know nothing but the will of his master and learn to obey it. As to himself, learning will do him no good, but a great deal of harm, making him disconsolate and unhappy. If you teach him to read, he'll want to know how to write. And this accomplished, he'll be running away with himself. The effect of his words on me was neither slight nor transitory. His iron sentence, cold and harsh, sunk like heavy weights deep into my heart and stirred up within me a rebellion. This was a new and special revelation, dispelling a painful mystery against which my youthful understanding had struggled and struggled in vain. To wit, the white man's power to perpetuate the enslavement of the black man. Very well, thought I. Knowledge unfits a child to be a slave. I instinctively assented to the proposition, and from that moment, I understood the direct pathway from slavery to freedom. It was just what I needed, and it came to me at a time and from a source whence I least expected it. He wanted me to be a slave. As a child, I had already voted against it.
Teaching a slave to read is severe, and it's even worse for the slave who learns. Miss Priscilla, I got a secret to tell you. I believe I can tell you, but please don't read it to a living soul. I gotta tell it to somebody, and I believe in you, and I need your help.
Joshua, I promise I will never speak of you. You can't depend on me. What is it, Joshua? What is it?
Well, you've been real good to me in this plantation. I know you'll understand. I like you and Master Curry and all the nice people, but I'm gonna run away. I promised my people I would help them go north on the Underground Railway. Two other fellas is going with me. We got it all planned out.
Well, Joshua, I just don't know what to say. I can hardly believe it. Not that I disapprove of your plans, but I just don't know how I would get along without you. You can depend on me. I shall breathe this to no one. I shall also do all that I can to help you. Listen, Joshua, come to the house tonight before you leave. I have some money and perhaps other articles I will give you that you may be able to use. And please, be careful, Joshua.
Miss Priscilla, you are so good. Many thanks to you. I'll never forget you. W-O-R-D. Word. W-O-R-D. Word.
Slaveholders sought to impress their slaves with a belief in the boundlessness of slave territory and of their own limitless power. Our notions of the geography of the country were very vague and indistinct. The distance, however, was not the chief trouble, for the nearer were the lines of a slave state to the borders of a free state, the greater was the trouble. Hired kidnappers infested the borders. Then, too, we knew that merely reaching a free state did not free us, that wherever caught, we could be returned to slavery. I knew something of theology, but nothing of geography. I really did not know that there was a state of New York or a state of Massachusetts. I had heard of Pennsylvania, Delaware, and New Jersey, and all the southern states, but was utterly ignorant of the free states. On the other hand, far away, back in the hazy distance where all forms seemed but shadows under the flickering light of the North Star, behind some craggy hill or snow-capped mountain, stood a doubtful freedom, half frozen, and beckoning us to her icy domain. This was the good to be sought. The inequality was as great as that between certainty and uncertainty. Upon either side, we saw grim death, assuming a variety of horrid shapes. Now we were contending with the waves and were drowned. Now we were hunted by dogs and overtaken, and torn to pieces by their merciless fangs. We were stung by scorpions, chased by wild beasts, bitten by snakes, and worst of all, after having succeeded in swimming rivers, encountering wild beasts, sleeping in the woods, and suffering hunger, cold, heat, and nakedness, were overtaken by hired kidnappers. This dark picture, drawn by ignorance and fear, at times greatly shook our determination, and not unfrequently caused us to rather bear the ills we had.
Well, man, your danger is not yet over. You will have to avoid traveling during the day and be very careful at night. You will have to cross Maryland and Delaware. There will be a group to receive you when you reach Philadelphia. Now follow my instructions carefully. You will follow the North Star from this point in the woods.
Right there.
After a few miles from here, you will come to a river.
A river?
Oh, Lord. It is wide, but not deep.
Oh, thank God. Thank you.
Wade through it at this point. And go to the east of the big road as you cross the river to avoid those going on the ferry. And keep east till you reach Delaware, where the signs are nailed to trees on the right-hand side. And looking northward, you will see trees with white paint smeared on it. Stay in the pathway. And don't speak above a whisper to each other. Run as fast as you can if you hear the hound.
We will.
Mr. Hanson, I swear to you, we'll reach that land of the free. And when I get there, I will give my service to God and my people. Thank you for being so nice to us.
Thank you. Thank you. We'll help Joshua. Much obliged, sir.
That is all we ask of you. We have helped over 5,000 of your people to escape. Here is enough food for the journey. Good luck.
Thank you, sir.
And may God bless. Again, I say, be very careful. And don't talk to any whites.
You won't, sir.
The punishment for us is as great as that for you slaves. They will throw us in prison. Oh, and in chains, and let us stay there till we die.
They won't catch us.
No,
we promise. No promise, sir. No. They won't catch us. Joshua, you must lead us. I'm gonna take one off the floor.
I'm coming.
If we make it, we'll be able to help other slaves escape. I wish we could help everybody.
Oh, I'm getting so worried. I don't think I can make it much longer.
Whatever happens, you must keep going, man. Sit here. Drink this here water from the glass.
Pat, we come too far to turn around now.
I know.
Don't give up.
I mean, we really need to get there.
I'll cheer him up or something.
All right.
Didn't my Lord deliver Daniel? Didn't my Lord deliver
Daniel and was every man?
He delivered
Daniel from the lion's den, Jonah from the belly of the whale, and the Hebrew children from the fiery furnace, and why not every man? Did my Lord deliver Daniel? Did my Lord deliver Daniel? And why not every man?
Down.
from out the wilderness, leaning on the Lord. I'm leaning on the Lord. I'm leaning on the Lord. I'm leaning on the Lord, who died on Calvary.
Well, I loved everybody when I
come out the wilderness. Come out the wilderness,
you know I loved everybody when I
come out the wilderness, leaning on the Lord. I'm a leaning on the Lord. I'm a leaning on the Lord. I'm a leaning on the Lord, who died on Calvary.
Tell me, how did you feel when you
come out the wilderness? Come out of the wilderness,
tell me, how did you feel when you
come out of the wilderness, leaning on the Lord. I'm leaning on the Lord. I'm leaning on the Lord. I'm leaning on the Lord, who died on Calvary. Come out the wilderness,
everybody,
come out the wilderness, leaning on the Lord. I'm a leaning on the Lord. I'm a leaning on the Lord. I'm a leaning on the Lord, who died on Calvary.
Well, my soul was so happy when I
come out.
Well, my soul was so happy when I
come out of the wilderness, leaning on the Lord. I'm a leaning on the Lord. I'm leaning on the Lord. I'm leaning on the Lord, who died on Calvary.
Immediately after authority had been given by President Lincoln to Governor John A. Andrew of Massachusetts to raise and equip two regiments of colored men for the war, I received a letter from George L. Stearns of Boston, a noble worker for freedom in Kansas, and a warm friend of John Brown, earnestly entreating me to assist in raising the required number of men. It was presumed that by my labors in the anti-slavery cause, I had gained some influence with the colored men of the country, and that they would listen to me in this emergency, which supposition, I am happy to say, was supported by the results. There were fewer colored people in Massachusetts than there are now. And it was necessary, in order to make up the full quota of these regiments, to recruit for them in other northern states. The nominal conditions upon which the colored men were asked to enlist were not satisfactory to me or to them. But assurances from Governor Andrew that they would in the end be made just and equal, together with my faith in the logic of events and my conviction that the wise thing for the colored man to do was to get into the army by any door open to him, no matter how narrow, made me accept with alacrity the work to which I was invited. The raising of the two regiments, the 54th and 55th, and their splendid behavior in South and Northern North Carolina was the beginning of great things for the colored people of the whole country, and not the least satisfaction I now have. In contemplating my humble part in raising them, is the fact that my two sons, Charles and Louis, were the first two in the state of New York to enlist in them.
Israel was in Egypt land.
Let my people go.
Oppressed so hard they could not stand.
Let my people go.
Smite your firstborn dead.
Let my people go. Go around, Moses, with God in Egypt land.
America from the tyranny of that despicable British monarch.
this is a later date. I am prepared to fight. Yes. I am prepared to fight for human rights. Our people are enslaved. And many whites are enslaved too, for they dare not speak the truth that is in their hearts. Human suffering is plaguing this country. Even the southern white man is fighting against his better judgment and against his God. That is, if he has ever known God. And for what? To please his associates. No, to please his confederates. And to hold on to his money-making machine, the Negro. Yes. Yes, I will go to the captain's office to offer advice I think might help.
Well, soldiers, there is truly a most among us. I, for one, am ready to follow Joshua to the bitter end.
Say, fellas, here's what our Sojourner Truth has wrote for our colored soldiers.
We are the valiant soldiers who have rested for the war. We are fighting for the Union, we are fighting for the law. We can shoot a rebel farther than a white man ever saw. As we go marching on, glory, glory, hallelujah.
That was good. Let's take the second verse.
Oh, everyone, the center where the flag is flying bright. We are going out of slavery. We are bound for freedom's fight. We mean to show to faithless how the colored men can fight as we go marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Man, this war. Just think of our own noble Sojourner Truth writing that song. Just give our women a chance and they'll ride as high as anyone else. Just the other day, I read that Harriet Tubman has been called the Moses of our people because she made 19 trips through the Underground Railroad and has helped over 300 of our brothers escape the shackles of slavery. The day will come when we will be first-class citizens, winning distinction in every walk of life. We are self-made men who have faced hell and damnation to get our freedom. With an opportunity of giving education, who knows what our children and their children will become? One can never imagine. These are words worth fighting for.
Come, come, let's not get so sentimental. Let's sing as Aunt Sojourner Truth still want us to sing.
They said your colored man that you shall live forever free. From the 1st of January 1863, we heard it in the river going rushing to the sea as the clear sounding on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Well, soldiers, I went to the captain's office. I had a discussion with Major General Hunter. He asked me many questions. He wanted to know how long I'd been in uniform. I told him
5 years ever since I arrived in Philadelphia. He said he would contact me sometime. And this seems to be it. I'll read it to you. Boston, Massachusetts. Dear sir, I am organizing 1st Regiment of volunteers with every prospect for success. Your name has been mentioned in connection with the command of the regiment by some friends in whose judgment I have confidence. I take great pleasure in offering you the position with the rank of colonel and hope that you may be induced to accept. Should you accept, I enclose a pass for Port Royal, of which I trust you will avail yourself at once. I am, with sincere regards, R. Saxton, Brigadier General.
Congratulations. By all means, Colonel, you must accept this position.
Thank you.
I congratulate you, Colonel. All men of color will follow you to the bitter end.
Soldiers, this is the most important step I've ever taken. We, the colored people of America, are here to stay. America cannot get rid of us. We are definitely American. From the first shedding of blood for liberty, one of ours flowed and mingled with that of the whites. That was Crispus Attucks of Boston, Massachusetts. He led a band of colored and white soldiers against the foreign mercenaries and the occupying professionals of the hated tyrant, the King of England. Dear of late, it was our brother, John A. Cleveland, who said, "I am dying for freedom. I could not die for a better cause." Follow me. Regiment, hit, put! Officer, who? You will meet me here tomorrow morning at 7:30 hour.
We mean to show the neighbors how the colored men can fight as we go marching on.
Another ground of hope for our people is in the progress of education. Everywhere in the South, the colored man is learning to read. Now, none denies the ability of the colored race to acquire knowledge of anything which can be communicated to the human understanding by letters. Our colored schools of the city of Washington compare favorably with the white schools, and what is true of Washington is equally true of other cities and towns of the South. Greatness does not come on flowery beds of ease to any people. We must fight to win the prize. No people to whom liberty is given can hold it as firmly and wear it as grandly as those who wrench their liberty from the iron hand of the tyrant. The hardships and dangers involved in the struggle give strength and toughness to the character, and enable it to stand firm in storm as well as in sunshine. Neither we nor any other people will ever be respected till we respect ourselves. And we will never respect ourselves till we have the means to live respectably. An exceptionally poor and dependent people will be despised by the opulent and will despise themselves. You cannot make an empty sack stand on end. A people which cannot save its earnings, which spends all it makes, and goes in debt when it is sick, can never rise in the scale of civilization, no matter under what laws it may chance to be. Put us in Arkansas, Kansas, or in Africa, and until we learn to save more than we spend, we are sure to sink and perish. A poverty-stricken class will be an ignorant and despised class, and no amount of sentiment can make it otherwise. This part of our destiny is in our own hands. If the time shall ever come when we shall possess in the colored people of the United States a class of men noted for enterprise, industry, economy, and success, we shall no longer have any trouble in the matter of civil and political rights. Do I hear you ask in a tone of despair if this time will ever come to our people in America? The question is not new to me. I have tried to answer it many times and in many places. When the outlook was less encouraging than even now, notwithstanding the great and all-abounding darkness of our social past, notwithstanding the clouds that still overhang us in the moral and social sky, and the defects inherited from a bygone condition of servitude, it is the faith of my soul that this brighter and better day will yet come. But whether it shall come late or come soon will depend mainly upon ourselves. We shall reap as we sow. There is no escape. The conditions of success are universal and unchangeable. The nation or people which shall comply with them will rise, and those which violate them will fall, and will perhaps disappear altogether.
Oh, freedom!
Gathering!
Oh, freedom!
toothbrush. Our teeth are very important to us because they are a part of us. They should be kept clean and free from food after each meal. We should comb and brush our hair every morning before coming to class. Children, what did I say about cleanliness yesterday? Mary.
You said we must wash our clothes and bodies often. You said we must wash our hands and face in a tub full of water with a soap and rag.
Very good. Tell me something else. Sammy?
Yes, ma'am. You said if we want others to respect us, we must respect ourselves. There is no difference in human beings but the color of our skin. God only made two people, and that was Adam and Eve, and everyone else came from them. There is only one race, and that is the human race.
Very good, Sammy. Very good, too. You must do all of the things that you learned in this class. Yes. You're going to have a spelling match. Please don't forget to tell your parents that we will have school tonight for all of them. All right, now we will have our spelling match. Row one on this side, row two on that side.
And on you, Margaret.
Margaret, please spell telescope.
T-E-L-A-S-C-O-P-E.
That's not right. Please have a seat. Wilhelmina, telescope.
T-A-L-E-S-C-O-P-E.
That's not right. Julia, you try.
Telescope. T-E-C-O-O-P.
That's not right either. Sammy, telescope.
T-E-L-E-S-C-O-P-E.
Very good. That was a difficult word. Everyone, please have a seat. We'll finish later. We have two very important guests with us from Philadelphia. They have played a very important part in the fight for freedom. All the clothes and other articles that we give you are sent down from these organizations by these people. They are interested in each of you. This lady is my own dear sister, Clara, the daughter of Colonel Joshua Terrell. Hello, class.
Hello, Mr. Terrell.
Miss Clara. And this lady is Miss Garson, a special worker of Boston. Good morning, class.
Good morning, Miss Garson.
Will either of you have something to say?
Children, I am greatly touched by your success and interest in your classes. Within a few years, you have made a great improvement, and it's because you really want to learn. I would like to take a message back to the people that to the board when I return to Boston. What shall I tell those people when I return?
Just tell them we are rising.
Won't you help me in the service of the Lord? I'm a rolling, I'm a rolling through an unfriendly world. I'm a rolling, I'm a rolling through an unfriendly world. Oh, preachers, won't you help me? Won't you help me in the service?
what to hear. Good evening. I would like to thank you all for your contributions. My father, Colonel Joshua Terrell, told you that you would soon see a boarding school on this spot for your children. And if you wanted one, you can make it known by giving money or what have you. We are going to sell these farm products for money. The money will be used to buy the things we do not have. Some of the men in the community will help make bricks, and we women can bring water from the spring, cook for the men, and do whatever our hands find to do.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
All right. Okay.
Miss Blair? Mr. Terrell, you've been teaching us a lot of things and all, but you know, you never taught us how to make these bricks. What I want to know is, who's going to teach us how to make these bricks?
You are perfectly right, Mrs. Sledge. The reason I have not taught you how to make bricks is because I don't know myself. My brother Harold, who will graduate from Hampton Institute in Virginia, he will be your teacher. He knows how to make bricks and build buildings. It is our sincere desire that every girl, boy, man, and woman have a chance to learn to read and write, cook meals for their family, and get the best living from the soil. But before we get too far from our lesson, let us take our Bible and turn to the 37th chapter of Psalms. And Miss Anderson, will you read the first two verses for us, please?
From the audience,
pleasure.
I'm going to read a small portion of the 37th Psalm. Fret not thyself because of evildoers, neither be thou envious against the workers of iniquity, for they shall soon be cut down like the grass and wither as the green herb.
Trust in the Lord and do good. So shall thy dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be.
Thank you, Mrs. Anderson. My sister Clara has brought in a very important article written by our father, Colonel Joshua Terrell. This article was written for the North Star, the paper founded by the great Frederick Douglass. Let me read it to you. You understand that all races at one time or another have been slaves. Many people have enslaved members of their own race. This country's first ships contained white men of Europe who were placed in slave chains, thrown in dungeons, and whipped unmercifully for the least crimes. They were given their choice to die in chains in Europe or come to America and die of hunger and exposure. Your being slave was different. You did no crime in Africa. You violated no law. Your parents were not brought over because they were sick or diseased or good riddance for Africa. The most select of the African tribes were brought to America. Count the achievements of the colored race. Think of some of the lessons we have read and the wonderful places we have filled in the Bible, which are definitely true. Do you remember reading that Ham, Shem, and Japheth were brothers? Ham is the source of the Negro. A great city and one of culture was built by his tribe. Solomon said, I am black, but conquered. He could be no other than a Negro, yet he was the wisest man God ever made. Christ has no particular race. He was a descendant of peoples of all races, and all nations proclaimed him as their savior. The one Negro feature that was so outstanding about him is given in the scripture of the old Bible that reads, his head was as lamb's wool. Yes. Cleopatra, the most beautiful woman in the world, was colored. Clara, do you have anything to add to Bob's article?
Well, you can see, my dear people, that we have a lot to be proud of as Negroes. You should lift up your head and put the past behind you. The future is bright, and as you make your contribution towards success by living and leading a decent life, you should think of the generational equality. Grasp every opportunity possible. Stick together no matter what
recite the Pledge of Allegiance and sing the first verse of Lift Every Voice and Sing.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Lift every voice and sing.
No disguising the fact that the American people are much interested and mystified about the mere matter of color as connected with manhood. It seems to them that color has some moral or immoral qualities, and especially the latter. They do not feel quite reconciled to the idea that a man of different color from themselves should have all the human rights claimed by themselves. When an unknown man is spoken of in their presence, the first question that arises in the average American mind concerning him and what must be answered is, of what color is he? And he rises and falls in estimation by the answer given. It is not whether he is a good man or a bad man. This does not seem to be of primary importance. Hence, I have often been bluntly and sometimes very rudely asked of what color my mother was and what color was my father. In what proportion does the blood of the various races mingle in my veins? Especially how much white blood and how much black blood entered into my composition. Whether I was not part Indian as well as African and Caucasian. Whether I considered myself more African than Caucasian or the reverse, whether I derived my intelligence from my father or from my mother, from my white or from my black blood, whether persons of mixed blood do permanently remain of the mixed complexion or finally take on the complexion of one or the other of the two or more races of which they are composed. Because of the crudity of these questions, I have often suffered. Can any colored man or any white man friendly to the freedom of all men ever forget the night which followed the first day of January 1863, when the world was to see if Abraham Lincoln would prove to be as good as his word? I shall never forget that memorable night when, at a public meeting in a distant city with 3,000 others, not less anxious than myself, I waited and I watched for the word of deliverance which we have heard read. Nor shall I ever forget the outburst of joy and thanksgiving that rent the air when the lightning brought to us the Emancipation Proclamation. By law, by the Constitution of the United States, slavery has no existence in our country. The legal form has now been abolished. By the law and the Constitution, the Negro is a man and a citizen, and has all the rights and liberties guaranteed to any other variety of the human family residing in the United States. He has a country, a flag, and a government, and may legally claim full and complete protection under the law. We have gone still further. We have laid the heavy hand of the Constitution upon the matchless meanness of caste, as well as upon the hell black crime of slavery. We have declared before all the world that there shall be no denial of rights on account of race, color, or previous condition of servitude. The advantage gained in this respect is immense. It is a great thing to have the supreme law of the land on the side of justice and liberty. It is the line up to which the nation is destined to march, the law to which the nation's life must ultimately conform.
I feel like I am just beginning to live again. In a few days, I will be able to walk around this plantation. Yes, this very plantation that was owned by my slave master. And I wanted to own it, and I said I vowed to own it, and I bought it. One can do anything he wants to do if he says his mind to do it. Well, I suppose I shouldn't do all of the talking. Let me hear from some of you children. Tell me, May, how are you and your family doing?
Well, Papa, it isn't much to tell you. As you know, I retired from teaching after 50 years of it. I thought I'd let the young ones carry on.
It was time for her to retire. We did not necessarily need her income, as my research pays a handsome amount.
Well, Grandfather Joshua, I'm still carrying on my missionary work. There's as much need as ever to help in the education of our people. Mm-hmm.
Well, Papa, biggest job I'm still an engineer. The biggest job I've had is a bridge over the Pelt, across the Pelt River. I wish you could see. Everyone sees it, they get the world's best.
Well, I'm plugging away at school, you know, hoping to do a good job in the field of law and make you all proud of me.
Amen.
Of course, I think I've made the best contribution of all. I kept the greatest man in the whole world happy and contented, and that is our own dear father. As your youngest son's father, I've tried to give food to the many hungry souls. My church, the Metropolitan, boasts 3,000 active members. And a little one on the way. We have a large daily nursery, good, where we have resident nurses to keep the members' children while they work. A factory in the basement makes robes and cakes for the choir. And an unemployment office gives work to all the members who are well and unemployed.
Good.
You see, Father, we try to do more than just our duty to improve the lives of our people.
That is great.
Wonderful. Just wonderful, son.
Well, Granddad, I suppose the greatest contribution I've made is to give to this world four lovely and progressive children. Flo, my oldest daughter, stays with the Metropolitan Office. Dick serves the country in the Air Force. And Bill, he's a recorder of these in Philadelphia. They were unable to come see you, but they wish you well. This is my youngest son, Jimmy.
Hello, great-grandfather.
How are you, Jimmy? Good to see you.
Oh, it's for you, grandfather. Let me read it. Dear grandfather, it is unfortunate that I can't be with you at this time. I have made and dedicated this record to you. Please play it as soon as you receive it. Love, love.
Oh,
that's very good.
I'm going to go to the conversation. Right now. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
man, Doctor. Can't you do anything to relieve him from his misery?
He's fading fast. He was such a great character.
Thank you.
before you all leave, I want you to meet somebody who's known Mrs. Boynton for a longer time than I have, and played a very important role 30 years ago when the Voting Rights Act was won. This was the man who went down on her behalf, and he wants to say, pay his tribute to her and to this cast right now. And this is Reverend James Bevel.
Thank you, Brother Speed, and Prophecy, and to Sister Amelia Boynton Robinson. When I lived in the Boynton Robinson back in 1964, I know she was a playwright. I know she was able to write a script of freedom in terms of the franchise of our people. And so I'm happy to be here to say to her, this cast, the young people, the players here, the actors, and to the musicians, thank you very much. And to those of you who have come out, I want to say thank you. I do have a bit of good news. We have been doing quite a bit of study on the whole problem of slavery and oppression. And of course, we've studied slavery and oppression in all history and all geographies. And we've discovered that slavery is the result of not having enforced scientific governments. And we've also discovered that scientific governments is easy as to understand and run as learning the alphabet. Which means that in the very few years, we will completely eradicate oppression and slavery from the planet. And that's good news. Because what has happened, isn't that just a few false assumptions that people never break out of? For instance, when Jesus was talking to his disciples, he, and some people, he said, listen, you must do this, and you must do this, and you must do this. And of course they asked him, why must we do this? He said, so that you can be the sons of your Father in heaven. Now, what Jesus did is clear up the question of the identity of man, because no one before that was clear about the identity of man. Now that we all know we're God's children, then we can end all of this creation, because we're all brothers and sisters. And that's the truth. Now, you don't believe that, and all kinds of stuff is in your head, but you got to get that stuff out of your head so that you can come into the movement. Now you know all these things happen in the city. You know about the attack upon the mayor, you know about the attack upon the people in the city. But that can only be solved, these problems can only be solved when people come and join the movement. When we went down in the 1960s, everybody told us that it would take 100 years for black people to get the right to vote. But when we began to work on the right to vote, very shortly we achieved the objective. Because we came out and we worked. And we worked on the true rights. And we were God's children. And so we need all of you in the movement, that we have to put on what we call LSD, live social drama. This is the drama on the stage. But we have to put a drama in history. And so we want all of you to join the movement. We want all of you to sign up because we have an atonement coming up October 16th this year, where all of the American people must come and atone for their sins and correct our nation, and we need all of you involved. And so I just want to thank Amelia for inspiring me, inspiring all of us, writing dramas for the stage, writing dramas in history, and she still plays through the years. And when I saw Amelia 3 years ago, I hadn't seen her 20 years. I said, Amelia, what's wrong with you? You're not getting any old. You look just like you're 65. I'm an old man now, and you look like a kid. And I thank her for her spirit, for her dignity, for her youth, for her spirit. And this is what happens to you when you work for the Lord and for the freedom of people. So I'm going to ask all of you to join Amelia in her new ministry. Slavery on this planet. God bless you, God bless you.
Egypt land.
Let my people go.
Oppressed so hard they could not stand.
Let my people go.
Moses said,
let my people go.
If not, I'll smite your firstborn dead.
Let my people go.